Jesus often attracted huge crowds from all over to hear him teach. One day, Jesus was sitting by a lake, and the crowd around him grew so large that he climbed into a boat and sat down, facing all the people on the shore. As he often did, Jesus taught the crowd using a parable, a short story containing a metaphor of what he wanted them to understand. Many people at the time were farmers, so Jesus used a story that they would quickly identify with. A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seeds fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still, other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop 160 or 30 times what was sown. Some of the disciples asked Jesus why he shared this story. So Jesus told them, "When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path." The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 160 or 30 times what was sown.
Winner, doesn't it? That's awesome. This is great. I had somebody in the 8 o'clock service want to know why I was wearing a suit. Okay, they asked me if I was wearing a suit because it was getting close to my birthday, and I said no, but be glad that this suit is covering my birthday suit, or we would all be in trouble. All right, I'm wearing a suit because it's colder outside, all right? It's not hot, so it makes it easy to want to wear a suit. If you feel like maybe you walked into heaven today, that was the plan, all right? This is pre-set up for tonight. Some of our kids are coming in for a little bit of our music today because it is a little commercial this morning for what's going to happen here tonight. Our kids have a play musical presentation at 6 o'clock tonight. So we hope you will come back, encourage the kids, and enjoy their presentation. We are looking forward to it very, very much. We want to say welcome to those of you who might be visiting us for the very first time. In the pew in front of you are some visitor cards. We would love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering when it comes by, and then next week through the mail, we'll send you information about the church. We promise we will not beat on your door, we will not bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information we hope will be helpful. Let me highlight a few announcements very quickly. There's a lot of stuff going on out under the pavilion today. So please, when you leave today, go out these side doors and take advantage of the things that are going on. Let me highlight what's out there. First of all, ladies, you have an event coming up on December the 1st. It's one of, I understand, I can't tell from personal experience because they've never let me attend, but the women have an ornament exchange the first week of December. This year, it's on December 1st. And it's always a full house, so tickets are available. They have great dessert and food stuff. And so there's a bit of a fee for this. It's $10, all right, for you to get your tickets, reserve your, and they'll tell you more information about it out there. But please go out and do that, all right, today. Second of all, ladies. Ladies, you're at the top of the list today, all right? There is, you can see Brandon Best out there, all right? He's at a table. And if you would be interested in taking a self-defense class next Sunday afternoon, right after the third service, I'm not sure why they're not making it available for us men. We need to be protected too, all right? But this is just for ladies, and it's being done, my understanding is because it's the shopping season. And ladies, you will be out a lot with packages in your hand and by yourself. And so they're doing a little self-defense class, all right? And so if you would be interested in doing that next Sunday afternoon, see Brandon Best in the pavilion and sign up for that class, all right? Kids play tonight. I've already mentioned that at 6 o'clock. Grief Share, Surviving the Holidays. If you signed up for that class, it's today from 1 to 3. It will be over in the Murbach building. And then not on your bulletin, there'll be a congregational meeting on December the 7th, all right, where we will present to you next year's budget, all right? So we would love to have you come, and it will be in the bulletin the next couple of weeks. A few prayer requests I want to share with you. For some, this has been a very challenging week, and so we want to be remembering to pray for each other. This last Friday, memorial services were held in Tulare for Milo's mom. It's good to see Milo, but where are you, Milo? There you are in the back. It's good to have Milo with us today, but please be remembering to pray for him and for his family. A beautiful program you put together, Milo. I just saw it this morning. Great job you did on that, so thank you so very much. This past Friday here at New Hope, we had the memorial service for Danny Boitano's dad. And so please be praying for the Boitano family. And this coming week, we will have the service here for Patrick Linares' father, part of our regular church family. John Mansfield's grandmother. John, where are you? There you are. 94 years of age. She is in the hospital. She's not doing well. She may go home to be with the Lord in the next day or two. So please be remembering the Mansfield family. And then Jim Critchfield is still in the hospital. We've had a little bit of up days, and we've had some down days. Just please continue to remember to pray for Jim. If you do go see him, visitors are good, okay? If you do go see him, I'm just preparing to you right now. He might sometimes say some things that you don't like. He called Tim Belcher tall and fat, okay? So I'm just kind of preparing you, all right? The tall part is accurate, all right? The tall part, I said. Yes, that's accurate. I didn't say the other part was. Okay? But you just be ready, okay? The wall of truth out here to sign. Somebody say, well, I signed it before. Have you signed this one? This is our second wall of truth. This has to do with the practices. We had up for 12 weeks the 10 key truths of the Bible that we build our life on. Now we have moved into the 10 key practices that affirm those 10 key truths. So take the opportunity. How many of you have read your chapter for this week? What's it on? That's good. That means you need to read the Bible in order to do Bible study. All right? But anyway, you will find 10 practices that you and I should be engaged in. If you believe those are 10 key practices, then go put your name out there on the wall of truth. All right? We'd love to have you do that. At this moment, also out on the pavilion, you're going to find a couple of tables with some Christmas trees on it and lots of angels hanging from them. This is angel tree time with Prison Fellowship. And before I say any more, we're going to watch the video because I think it might do a better job explaining it than I could. So let's sit back and watch.
I wish I could see my dad. I wish my family could be together for Christmas.
I wish I had a dolly.
A new dress.
And a soccer ball.
I wish I could have my mom.
I wish my dad could play catch with me.
I wish. 2.7 million children have a simple wish this Christmas. To feel special. To feel remembered. To feel loved by a parent who's far away. You can help. It starts with a gift, a simple present from their parent reminding them they are loved and not forgotten, and the gift of knowing the love and support of their Heavenly Father. This calls for believers to take action. So while mothers and fathers are behind bars, kids are left behind, families torn apart. This calls for churches across America to rise up and deliver gifts to children on behalf of parents in prison. You and your church become the hands and feet of Jesus you deliver God's love and bring hope to those who need it most. Families are restored. Children find joy. Parents experience God's grace. It starts with a gift. Since 1982, Angel Tree, with the help of thousands of churches across the country, has reached more than 9 million kids with a gift, the gospel, and a message from their incarcerated parent. These 2.7 million kids need to feel their parents love this Christmas, and they need to know Jesus loves them, starting with the ones right here in your community. It's simple. It calls believers to put their faith into action. It inspires you and your family to live out the real meaning of Christmas. You bless the child of a prisoner with a gift and the good news of Jesus Christ. Every child has a story. Every child has a wish. Every child deserves a chance. It starts with a gift. It starts with you. This Christmas, change the life of a child forever.
For every I wish, we need to hear an I will. And that will come from you and from me today as we walk out these doors when service is over. We go to the Christmas trees. We take an angel off. Do not leave without seeing the person at the table. They need to get a little information from you so nobody gets missed or forgotten. So we do need to follow up where they are. On that angel will be the name of a child, their age, their interest, their sizes, and you are to purchase a gift, all right? Value not to exceed $25, all right? And bring back here, and we have 2 weeks to get this done. We have approximately 200 angels out there, and we've been doing this for 20 years here at New Hope. And there are some who have followed some of their angels for the past 12, 15, 18 years. I know that I believe it was last year, graduation time. 2 years ago, you and Lindsay went to his graduation of one of their first Angel Tree young people that they sponsored. And so they have stayed with him throughout the years. So I trust you'll take the opportunity to go out the double doors, pick up your angel, and bring back that gift in the next 2 weeks. At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. Wait on us as we have our tithes and offerings. And I think we have a little promo during offertory for our play tonight. All right? All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the privilege of sharing life with you this week. Thank you that on some dark and dreary days, by that I'm not talking about foggy days, I'm talking about the dark and dreary days of the soul, where because of death, hurt, grief, sorrow, loss, pain, surgeries, uncertain requests, that Father, we have faced some difficult moments. Father, thank you that your strength has been sufficient and your hope has got us through. It is your hope that puts winds in our sails on a difficult day. It is your comfort that makes the sorrow bearable. And it's your promises of your abiding presence, Father, that lets us know we will come out of the valley and we can see the mountaintop again. We love you for the privilege of giving and sharing today. We say thanks. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I thought that since today's theme and subject has to do with Bible study, that a great way to kind of start this segment out would be to give you a brief Bible quiz. See how you do. Okay? Not as the intent to discourage you from Bible study, but maybe with the interest of engaging in Bible study. So I have five questions I'm going to ask you, and I will give you the answer very quickly after I ask the question. And the reason for doing that is most of you have Google on your phone, so if I give you too long, you'll find the answer, all right, without knowing it. And so I will ask you to keep track of the right answers that you got, okay? So here is question number one. Where is the first tennis match mentioned in the Bible? The first tennis match mentioned in the Bible. Asher, that's good, but no. When Joseph served in Pharaoh's court. First tennis match. Okay? All right. Second question. Which Bible character had no parents? So I say Joshua. What was it? And tell us why. He was the son of Nun. Good. All right. All right. Good. Yeah, you guys are warming up here. Question number three. What kind of man was Boaz before he got married? Say good, good. Yeah, that's true. But the ruthless is correct, attaboy Gene. He was ruthless. He married Ruth before he married her. He was ruthless. All right, good. What is one of the first things that Adam and Eve did after getting kicked out of the Garden of Eden? They raised Cain. Their sons, Cain and Abel. All right, y'all with me on that one? Last question. What excuse did Adam give to his children as to why they no longer lived in Eden? Well, he wasn't quite that blunt, but close. What he said was, "Your mother ate us out of house and home." Did anybody get all five of those correct? Okay, I get to keep my gift then, all right? Actually, let me get a little serious now. Most of us who are Christians, and if you are here today and you're not exactly sure what that means, let me assure you, we say that term Christian with a great sense of humility. That's not a prideful statement. We can be thrilled with the fact that we are a Christian, but we know that the only reason that we are a Christian is by the grace of God. It is a free gift that is offered to every one of us. It is offered to you just as it has been offered to me. And you will receive it on the same basis that I was able to receive it. And that is to reach out, confess my sin, and say thanks and receive the gift of salvation. It's why in our first 10 weeks of this study called Believe, the first three truths that we build our life on is there is a God who is. This God who is, who always has been, always will be, is a God who wants to be personal. And He gets personal with you and me on the basis of salvation, a free gift that comes from God that He offers to us. And so for most of us who are Christians, we would admit today that we entered into a relationship with Jesus Christ because we have come to at least a minimal understanding about ourselves that we are dysfunctional. Yes, minimally. I'll get to the maximum minimum, but minimally, we realize that personally we are dysfunctional. And ultimately, we conclude and agree with the Scriptures that we are corrupt. We are sinful. It's what it means to become a Christian. We've come to recognize that about ourselves. At that moment, upon that confession, when we became a Christian, we now know that what it means to be a Christian is that we are now a child of God, and that we now have a reservation confirmed in our Father's house in a place called heaven. We know that minimally of what that means to be a Christian. I am now a child of God. I'm His son or His daughter, and when I die, I know I'm going to heaven. Agreed? Okay, all right. So next question. Now that we know we're a child of God and we know we have a reservation in heaven, was the influence of our dysfunction and our corruption instantaneously gone? Yeah, amen to that one. No, it wasn't. Though our parentage changed, we moved from sinner to saint, and though our destination changed from hell to heaven, our dysfunction and our corruption, though forgiven, still is around. We become a brand new babe in Jesus Christ. We are an infant. We are not full grown and mature. From a theological perspective, doctrinally, we can say it this way. Our position in Christ was established at the moment we confessed our sin and accepted Christ as our Savior. Our position as a Christian was established. But our condition is just getting started. Was a whole lot different about you the next morning after you became a Christian? In the way in which you thought and behaved and lived? Probably not. Your position had changed, and that position is going and should significantly influence you. But man, the very first day, okay, what's next? Our condition's just getting started. It's a little bit like this. It's kind of like somebody giving you a lifetime membership to a health club. You're a member. First day you show up, do you look like the guys and the gals who've been going for years? Probably not. You're a member. Just as I become a member of God, my position is I am a member of His family. Just as the card says, I'm a member of this health club. But my conditioning hasn't started yet. It will change and improve as I spend time in the gym, as you and I spend time in God's gym, His Word. Our condition will become conformed to my position. Does that make sense without getting too technical? Have I lost you yet? Okay, good. Any of you who would have said yes, wouldn't say it out loud anyway. 2 Corinthians 3:18 gives us a little framework to work from. Paul said this, "And we all," who's left out? Nobody. "With unveiled faces, we contemplate the Lord's glory." Now that we are a Christian, you and I have an opportunity, with the scales removed from our eyes, the veil pulled back, we get a chance to look into God's Word and see more clearly than we ever did before. And as we look in here, who do we see? We see Jesus. Clearly. Unveiled. We see His glory. And it's kind of like walking to gym and seeing that gym rat, all right, who's over there in that back section lifting up, you know, all the free weights. He's a stud. I never look at the women over there. Okay? Only have eyes for one. Got to decide if I need to confess now or after the service. But anyway. You look over there, all right? That is one day the process of hope where you get. You and I read and hear, and we see Christ. And that's an image. And now as we spend time in His gym, we have the hope that one day this skinny little body, okay, this used to be skinny little body, can one day look like Him. We are being transformed into His image with ever-increasing glory. Where does it come from? From the Lord, who is the Spirit. Paul writes in the book of Ephesians, Chapter 6, verse 10, these words, "Finally," in other words, I spend enough time here, "finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power." Let's see if I can make this really practical before we jump in. When you have weeks like Milo had this past week, when you have weeks like the Boitanos and the Linares family have had this week, when you have weeks like Kathy and Jim have had this week, are you living that week in the strength of the Lord and in His mighty power? Or are you living that week on your own resources? Are you living that week with your condition matching your position? Or are you living that week in the strength of your dysfunction and your corruptness? And what makes the difference in the way in which we live that week is how much of this is here. And this cannot get to here until it has first gotten to here. And it does not get from here until we pick it up from the coffee table or the bedstand or the bookshelf. And that's what we're going to talk about today. If we are to be spiritually formed in Christ, if this transformation is actually going to take place, then we must implement a couple of appropriate things. Three things, and I call this actually Dallas Willard, all right? A brilliant, brilliant guy in a book called Retrospection. He said, if we are going to be spiritually formed and developed in Christ, there must be an appropriate measure of three things in our lives. Number one, vision. That's what Paul talked about in 2 Corinthians 3:18. With unveiled faces, we contemplate, we get a vision of the incredible glory of God. We become aware of this risen Savior whose name is Jesus Christ, who this season called Christmas and Easter is all about. We get an idea of who He is, and we stare and we gaze at Him and we say, wow, I want to be Him. In my younger days, I wanted to be Joe Montana. Actually, I just saw him the other day on TV. Maybe in my older days, I wouldn't mind being Joe Montana. I could never be him. I could never imitate him. I could never throw a football. I could never read a defense. I could never do any of that like him. No matter how much conditioning I did, that could never be accomplished. But the Bible tells us, if we see a vision of who Jesus Christ is, Paul says, we can be transformed in ever-increasing glory to where we look just like Him. So when the world sees you, when the world sees me, when the world sees Milo on the week that he loses his mother, when he sees Danny on a week that he loses his father, the world can look at them and see Christ. That's a promise. But that comes through the conditioning of the Word of God in our life. So we must have a vision of who Jesus is. Second of all, then there must be intention. There must be intention in our life. We have to have an appropriate amount of intention to see the vision brought to fruition in our life. Good health doesn't happen by accident. Spiritual transformation doesn't happen by accident. There is a vision, and then there is the intention to see the vision accomplished in our life. And how is that done? By the third thing called means. What are the means whereby my intentions are carried out, and the end result is the ever-increasing glory of God. So, vision, intention, and means. Short way to remember that is VIM. We don't use that word very often, but there is a word called vim. We usually associate it with vigor, vim and vigor. All right, good, good. And that actually, that word vim comes from a Latin word, and it's pretty incredible, but I don't have time to spend there today. Just know it's a pretty cool word. Vision, intention, and means. Listen to this. Page 205 in your Believe book, Hebrews 4:12 in your Bible. Either turn in your Bibles or tap your phone, whichever one you need to do to find that place in the Bible. Turn or tap. Here is what the writer of Hebrews says about this book. We call the Bible, or I've referred to today as God's gym. For the Word of God is alive and it's active. Are you? Are you spiritually alive? In other words, have you been born again? And are you active in God's truth? For the Word of God is alive and active. It's sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul, and it will divide soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes behind the thoughts that you contain in your heart. Have you ever done something good for somebody, but you didn't want to? Your intent did not match your behavior. God knew it. And if you read your word, you would be aware of it. And God would have the opportunity to change the intent so it would match your behavior. That's the beauty of being in the Word. It's also one of the reasons some folks don't want to be in the Word, is because they don't want their intent evaluated. They want to keep it in camo gear. The writer of the letter to Hebrews teaches by analogy that Scripture is more powerful than any sword. Yet it works much in the same way. For as we hold God's Word before us while we're moving through life, it can cut through any and every issue, dividing each into good and into evil. It can help us understand the behavior which is righteous and that which is wrong, showing us that what we are to do and showing us how to live. Like a sword, God's Word can be used as an offensive weapon that will help us grow and mature, and it can be used as a defensive tool to protect us against oncoming evil. Key question for this morning: why do I study the Bible? That's a question for you to ask yourself. Not why does Tim study the Bible, but why do you study the Bible? And I think the life of Jesus gives us a personal perspective about why we should. So I would invite you to turn to Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11, in your real Bible or in your phone Bible, all right? Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. You see, we should study God's Word with the intent of letting it guide our very lives just as Jesus did. Everything that we do should derive its source and its direction and its leadership out of this particular book. What we buy, what we give, what we throw away, what we hold on to, how we treat others. Basic things of life should derive its source from this book. I know of a family that's struggling. Grown kids. And they've got two of their grown kids who won't speak to each other in the same house. It's gotten so bad, kids are asking if the other one's going to be there. And if they are, I'm not coming. And you're saying, Tim, the Bible has something to say about that? Absolutely. The Bible says, kids, honor your father and your mother. You might not like your sibling. Doesn't negate the fact that you're to honor your father and your mother, and that behavior is dishonorable. I don't care how old we are, we never have the right to dishonor our parents. I don't have to obey them anymore. Thank goodness. But I do still have to honor them. I've often said, one of the reasons that my period of rebellion was so short as a teenager, I didn't have perfect parents, but I did have loving, caring, compassionate parents. And I did not want to hurt them, and I did not want to bring dishonor to them by them hearing about things that I may have done. And so I chose the vast majority of the time not to do things that would dishonor them, that would bring displeasure to them. And if that can be true about parents who are flawed, shouldn't it be even that much more true about our Heavenly Father who has no flaws? And He's given to us the means whereby we can live that kind of life. And this book gives us direction about all the practical things of daily living. So let's read Matthew chapter 4, begin at verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. And the tempter came to him and said, notice the wisdom of the devil. He came when he was tired and hungry. If he did that to Jesus, he will do that to you. When your defenses are down, when you were tired and weak and hungry, he will seize those opportunities to do his worst work. If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Anything wrong with the Creator of the universe who spoke the world into existence out of nothing, who changed water into incredible wine? Anything wrong with turning stones to bread? No. That in itself would not have been a sinful act. But guess what, folks? On this occasion, Satan made it a selfish act. And selfishness is sin. Just as he tempted Eve. Oh, God didn't really mean you can't eat of that because you'll become... He changed He changed a sinful act and he kind of twisted it so you wouldn't see the selfishness behind it. And what did Jesus do? Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." And then the devil took him to the holy city, Jerusalem, and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," challenged his authority, "throw yourselves down, for it is written, he will command the angels concerning you. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." And again, the devil took him to the very high mountain and showed him the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. He said, "All this I will give to you if you will bow down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." And what happened next? The devil left him and the angels came and attended him. Jesus responded to Satan's temptation with only one weapon on all three occasions. And the weapon was that which was written, the Word of God. In those days, it was strictly the Old Testament. New Testament had not yet been written. So Jesus, when he quoted Scripture all three times, he quoted out of the Old Testament. In fact, he quoted all three times out of the book of Deuteronomy. The first temptation of Satan was to entice Jesus into performing a miracle to meet his own physical needs. And Jesus' response comes out of a verse in Deuteronomy 8:3, which says, "He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna." This is what happened with the Israelites in the wilderness. God humbled them and then he fed them. He provided for them every single day with manna. During the night, manna would fall from heaven. Little small wafers of bread would fall and float down. They would open up the tent doors and they could reach outside their tent and gather this manna, this daily bread. And they were told, "Take just enough for today because you can't store it up. Take just enough for today. Take enough for today. It will nourish you." And he quotes this, "Feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Satan's second temptation was to lure Jesus into asking God for proof of his love and to care for him out of a completely selfish act. And Jesus' response comes out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16, that says, "Do not put the Lord your God to a test as you did at Massah." And go check out what they did there someday. And then Satan's third temptation was an attempt to induce Jesus to directly serve him and join him in authority over all of Satan's stuff on the earth. And Jesus' response in Deuteronomy 6:13 is what he quotes. He says, "Fear the Lord your God and serve him only, and take your oaths only in his name." I don't know if you noticed something in the reading of that story, but in the second temptation, Satan quotes Scripture. Jesus wasn't the only one quoting Scripture. Satan knows the word too. Psalm 91 verses 11 and 12 is what Satan quoted to Jesus, proving that he knows the word. But he has shown that he will only use it against God for his own selfish purposes. That is why you and I need to know this word so we can counteract the subtle shifts that Satan makes in our thoughts as he tempts us to go against God's word. Notice also that the temptations grew in scope as each one failed. The first one was to kind of fulfill a personal need. And then it went on to, "Hey, you need to do this so you'll be protected." And then he pushed him to the limits of greed. Satan was in fact zooming out from inward appetite to outside influence. If Jesus battled his arch enemy with only the Word of God, then you and I, as his children, should also make this our only sword of defense to defeat Satan with. To wield his Word, we must know his Word, as Jesus so succinctly showed us in this particular story. Jesus also frequently quoted from the Old Testament passages while he taught. In one of his post-resurrection appearances to his disciples, Jesus ties himself directly to the Scriptures of the Old Testament and the revelation of those words when he says in the Gospel of Luke chapter 24, verses 44 and 45, Jesus said to them, his disciples, This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me, where? In the law of Moses, and by the prophets, and in the Psalms. And then he opened up their minds so they could understand the scripture. Don't miss this. These disciples were Jewish men. They had grown up hearing the Old Testament scriptures. Much of it they put to memory. They knew the law of Moses. They knew the Psalms. They knew the prophecies about the coming Messiah. But get this, until Jesus, they had the word here. But until Jesus opened their minds, they could not get the truth from here to here. It takes Jesus in our lives to help us to begin to understand this book. And notice, this is at the end of 3.5 years. So some people say, Tim, I read the Bible and I just can't understand it. You want my advice? Keep reading the Bible. Keep reading the Bible. God will eventually, by His presence in you and a recognition of your dependence upon it, He will enable you to open it up. There are passages of Scripture that I have known for years and never understood them. And all of a sudden, one day in reading, how stupid could I have been? That is so easy. That wasn't because I got any smarter, folks. It was because the Christ in me opened up the understanding. Why? Because I needed it then. I might not have needed it before, but I needed it then. And He helped me see something I had missed before. That is the role of Christ in us. You see, Jesus not only authored the Scriptures, but He came to fulfill and live out every single page. Seeing His constant intertwining of the Word into His ministry shows us the vital importance of knowing and understanding and memorizing and applying the Bible to our own lives. So what's the key idea for today? I study the Bible so that I can know God and His truth, and I will find direction for my life. While this Bible may look like a book that contains pages and ink, Scripture tells us this is a living Word with God's own breath. His words are not dormant on a page, but they're active in the lives of those who will consume them and then apply them to their lives. The believer who attempts to live the Christian life with their Bible gathering dust is like a construction worker trying to build a skyscraper without any blueprints. What is the point without the plan? What is the purpose without the message? God's Word cuts to the core, acting much like a surgeon's scalpel, exposing what is in our minds for Him to do His work in us that only the Creator can do. This Word gets under our skin and it gets below the surface of our life. But the Bible shows us who we actually are, judging our true beliefs. As we read it, as we soak in it, and as we apply its truth, Scripture performs open heart surgery on us. Just like a personal counselor, God's Word goes straight to source of the issues of our life, connecting with and changing our actions, our thoughts, and even our very motives. The most basic essential for any personal life and for any church family is a commitment to the hearing and the learning and the applying of God's truth. At the time of the first century church, this meant listening to the apostles' teaching and reading the scriptures that they had at that point in time. If you have your Bibles open, find the book of Acts chapter 17, verses 11 and 12. Interesting two verses. Here's what the writer of Acts says. He says, "Now the Berean Jews," Jews who lived in Berea, "they were of more noble character than those who lived in Thessalonica." How would you like it if you lived in Thessalonica? What if somebody said, those people on Sunday morning meeting at New Harvest Church are of more noble character than those meeting at New Hope? What made the difference? The wonderful thing about the Bible, if you keep reading, it will tell you. "For they," the Bereans, "received the message with great eagerness, and they examined the Scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true." If the Berean Christians tested what Paul preached by the Word of God, you all ought to be testing what Tim preaches about the Word of God. You should be in it every single day to find out if I'm telling you the truth. As a result, many of them believed, as did a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. In these verses, we see an illustration of what can happen when people correctly respond to the Word of God. What did this brief story tell us? The Bereans received the Word of God. They received it with eagerness. Did you come to church today with the intent of receiving God's Word into your life? Was there a sense of anticipation and expectation? The term here is eagerness. Could you barely wait to get inside the doors of New Hope today because of what God might teach you through prayer, through music, through the opening of His Word? Think about what it's like to go to a World Series game with your favorite team playing. Think what it would be like to go to a Super Bowl with your favorite team playing. Think what it would be like to go to Nordstrom's with an unlimited credit card that you never had to worry about paying off. Would there be eagerness? Does that compare to how you came to church today? That's why the Bereans were more noble than the Thessalonians. It could be that's why New Harvest might have been, how did they say it? More noble in character. Because they were eager to hear the Word of God. Not eager to hear Mitch Ribera, not eager to hear Tim Roland, but eager to hear the Word of God. That's what was said about them. There was a readiness. I wonder how many of us came with that kind of expectation. If you and I are not reading the Bible on a regular basis, we will never know its truths that are contained here. According to the Barna Research Group, their survey said that less than 50% of Americans opened their Bible once during the week. I'm not gonna do my own survey here. I don't want to know. Did you open it this week? 82% think that God helps those who help themselves is a direct quote from the Bible. And in case you're in doubt, the answer is no. The Bible does not say that because God knows we cannot help ourselves and He offers His ready help. There are those who think cleanliness is next to godliness, is a proverb. Though I'm grateful all of you probably bathed before you came this morning, I'm very grateful. But it's not biblical. 63% cannot name the four Gospels. Okay. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. You all would know that if you left here today. Okay? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. 58% do not know that Jesus is the one who preached the Sermon on the Mount. He did. And 52% do not know that the book of Jonah is found in the Bible. Which reminds me of a story. I heard about a rather lovely Christian woman who did lots of flying for her work, but she hated flying. It made her extremely nervous. So she always took her Bible on the plane, and as soon as she sat down, she would get her Bible out. And for landings and takeoffs, she would always read her Bible because it gave her comfort. One day as she got in her seat and she pulled her Bible out, she was sitting next to a man who snickered at her as she pulled her Bible out. And he looked at her and said, "Do you really believe all that stuff?" She said, "Of course I do. This is the Bible, God's Word." He said, "Well, what about that guy who was swallowed by a whale?" She replied, "Oh, you mean Jonah? Yeah, that's in the Bible. I believe that." Still smirking, the man said, "Well, how do you suppose he survived all that time inside the fish?" And the lady said, "Well, I don't really know. I guess when I get to heaven, I'll ask him." And the man said back to her, "Well, what if he isn't in heaven?" And she replied, "Then you can ask him." Pretty sharp woman. You see, This lady received the Word of God, every part of it, devoted to it, just like believers in the early church, just like believers in Berea, and it ought to be just like believers right here in Clovis, California. They received the Word. Number two, they researched the Word. Not only did they receive it, but they searched it out. They wanted to check to see that Paul was telling them the truth. They listened to Paul's preaching. They received it. They did this daily. Just as the Israelites gathered manna every day, so it's the duty and privilege of Christians to study the Word every day. Just as the traveling Israelites had a cloud leading them by day and a pillar of fire at night, we have God's truth, which is our moment-by-moment GPS system. The Bereans were like the blessed man of Psalm chapter 1, whose delight was in the law of the Lord, and on the law he meditated day and night. They pored over their Bible, comparing Scripture with Scripture, evaluating the Word they were hearing from the apostles by the absolute counsel of God's Word, and that is precisely what we ought to be doing. What about you? Do you welcome the message of the gospel as the Bereans did? Do you study it with passion, enthusiasm, zeal, delight, and hunger? If we don't do this daily, we'll either just accept what somebody else says is truth and be led into error, or we won't hear what God is saying to us in the first place, and thereby we will fail to obey Him. The last thing these Bereans did is they responded to the Word of God. They received, they researched, and last of all, they responded. And you know what the response was? Many Jews believed, and many Greek women believed, and many Greek men believed. They believed the truth of God. The Bereans wanted to hear from God so that they could live for God. And so should you and I. We see then that the exposure of God's truth, the content of this book, must first inform the head. It should then travel 18 inches and transform the heart. And then it finally should be fleshed out in the reformation of our hands and our feet and our lips and our thoughts. Key application, what difference does this make in the way in which you live every day? Number one, you should regularly study and read God's Word. We're getting ready to come to the first of the year. What a great time to start a Begin the Bible Reading program. Get your phone out, download a free app, YouVersion. It's great. You got devotions on it. You got a Bible reading plan. There's about 13 different ones you can choose. You might forget your Bible, but most of y'all never forget your phone, and you can have it right there. Okay? You can have it right there and wake up to it every morning. Max Licato has a free app. Download his daily devotional. Read the verses. My Utmost for His Highest. Free download. Okay? Makes it so easy, but get into it. Number two, we come to see that studying God's Word in community with other believers is of great value. I'm preaching to the choir now because you're here. Doing this once a week is good for us. But not just once a week. That's why you ought to be part of a small group. Because in small group, you can go deeper than we can on a Sunday morning. In small group, four things will happen. Connect, grow, reach, serve. Those four things. You connect with others. You grow in your study of God's Word. You reach and you serve. That's why you need to be part of a community. Big community called church, small community called small group. And then we align our lives to the Bible because we believe it's from God. Is your attitude towards this book, I'm going to obey what it says? Or is your attitude toward this book, I'm going to see what it says and then decide if I'm going to obey? You understand the difference? If you read the book first to see if you want to obey, then who's sitting on the throne of your life? You. Then it's up to you to deal with tough times and bad weeks and difficult days. Because you've set yourself up to the authority. You'll obey yourself rather than God. See, the attitude needs to be, whatever God says, I will do. Wherever God says go, I will go. To whomever God says care, forgive, love, share, I will. When God says confess, I confess. When God says, repent, I repent. And repentance isn't just confession. Repentance means I will now go in another direction. And that is God's direction. We must go to the Scriptures regularly. God's Word has the right to permeate our lives. We will receive precepts and promises and principles from it. Out of God's Word, we are shown how to engage in family relationships. We are taught how we are to function within His family called the church. We gain insights how to be good stewards of His resources. We are taught what eternity will be like. And so we don't fear death, we embrace it. We see how much God cares and loves His creation, and we live by His precepts. I love what Max Lucado said in one of his books. He said, God loves you just the way you are, but He loves you so much He refuses to leave you the way we are. He wants us to be transformed into the image, the glorious image of His Son, Jesus Christ. I could be transformed from an outer shape doughboy to Atlas as I study the Word of God. I can be transformed from weak sinner to the glorious child of God. Doesn't that excite you? Doesn't that thrill you? The wise man wrote in the book of Proverbs, who has gone up to heaven and come down? Whose hands have gathered the winds? Who has wrapped the waters in his coat? Who has established the ends of the earth? What is his name and what is the name of his son? Surely you know. Every word of God is flawless and he is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Paul in 1 Thessalonians 2:13 says, and we thank God, how often? Continually. Why? Because when we receive the Word of God, which we have received from God Himself, we accepted it not as words from human lips, but it actually is the voice and the Word of God speaking to me, which is at work in me. And do you know to who this is at work in? Paul tells us, this Word will be at work in those who believe. Do you believe? Do you believe? And do you believe it enough to be in it every single day? Let me wrap up. What if for one week, you exchanged your mobile phone for your Bible? Anywhere you normally take your phone and pull it out, you take your Bible and pull it out instead. Anytime you normally look at your phone to Google something, you look at God's Word. The time you spend calling and texting and browsing on your phone is traded for time in the Scriptures. If you normally place your phone next to you at a business meeting or by your plate at a dinner table, how about putting your Bible there? Some of you are saying, oh, Tim, I do that. I have 13 translations on my Bible. Yeah, but is it open? Which app is open? This line of questions is not intended to trigger guilt in your life. Rather, these questions are designed to inspire us to increase our engagement with the One who can truly change not only our lives, but also change the lives of those around us. As those Berean Christians believed and put into practice what they read, many others believed also. I saw that happen Friday afternoon in a memorial service right here as a man who, to my knowledge, have never publicly proclaimed his faith in Jesus Christ powerfully, directly, proclaimed his faith in front of lifetime friends and said, the reason I am good today is because God has been good in my life. Every prayer I prayed, he did not answer the way I wanted, but every prayer I prayed, he answered, and it made the difference in why I'm standing here today. I was sitting right there and I just wanted to shout because God's Word had made a difference in his life, and I'm convinced because it made a difference in his life, it is now making a difference in the lives of some others as well. God wants to work His Word in and through us.
Luke 6:48 says this in the message. If you work the words into your life, if you work these words into your life, then you are like a smart carpenter. Mike, you ever work with a dumb carpenter? Okay. Book says if you get this and you put it here, it's like a smart carpenter who dug deep and he laid the foundation of his house on bedrock. And when the river burst its banks, Jesus doesn't pull any punches. There'll be times in your life when things come flooding in that want to wipe you out. But he said, when you work with a smart carpenter and you build your house on bedrock, when the river bursts its bank and it crashes against the house, nothing could shake it. Why? Because it was built to last. Are you built to last? Are you built to last until the day God takes you from this earth and he puts you forever in your lasting dwelling place? If you are, then you don't have to be afraid to walk across the street and help a neighbor. And you don't have to be afraid to go and keep that doctor's appointment. And you don't have to be afraid to get on a plane and go to Africa. Because God is able. Do you believe that? If we are to be spiritually formed in Christ, we must implement, remember, the appropriate vim. Let's close with this. What's vim? V stands for vision. Do you have a vision of the glorified Savior who says, when you see me, you can see yourself, so that when others see you, they see me? Do you have that vision? The I stands for intention. When you've seen the vision, are you prepared to be intentional about seeing that vision brought to reality in your life? And the M stands for means. What is the means whereby those intentions are carried out and the vision is accomplished? It is the study of this book, so that this becomes alive in you. Otherwise, folks, you're just dead men walking. But with this alive in you, you have something to offer to all the other dead men walking. And what is the antidote for death? Life. Life. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And the life he puts in you, he'll share through you, and he'll give it to others. You ready for a little vim in your life? Vision, intention, and means. Let's pray. Our Father, there is no way that human lips can adequately describe the power and the influence of what your word ought to be in our lives. But I hope by the presence of your Spirit, who not only directed the minds and the pens of the men and women who wrote this book, but he is also the same Spirit who wants to direct the minds and the hearts and the wills of each of us today. I trust by his presence, by his authority, by his power, that any of us who may be here this morning who do not have a love for your word, we will pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I have missed out on so much already. I pray that you give me a love for your word so that the vision I have seen today can be carried out in my life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Out.